And don't forget about the time limit.
Talk about studies that Ian Stevenson was a professor at the University of Virginia. He studied a great number of cases of children who claimed to remember a past life. He called them cases of the reincarnation type. And he did a lot, yes. And then I myself also studied some 100 cases. At really the encouragement of Stevenson, I worked with him for some time. And I published this book here, which sort of describes my work and a lot, many cases that we found. Well, how do you investigate cases of children who claim to remember past life? First, we must interview the child, we interview the parents, we interview brothers and sisters and playmates to see what the child has been saying that is interpreted as something about the past life. And then the question, of course, is, can this what they're saying be verified in any way, or is it all just fantasy and nonsense? So the crucial question is what they're saying, can it be verified in any way? Is there any kernel of truth in it? And that is what Stevenson tried and did with quite some success. And I also later did in the same way. For example, could it be that the child has learned what he is talking about just from people in the surroundings? Or is it something that genuinely comes from the child that they couldn't have known anything about? Yes, and then can we find a deceased, a dead person who was left alive that is in line with what the child has been saying? Well, I will present some 3-4 cases that I have studied of this kind. But it is not only that these children have memories, apparent memories. They will often say about the family they are born in, like, you are not my mother, this is not my family, I have another family and I want to go back to my previous family. That's very common. And then, of course, it claims to remember events of the past in the previous life. And then one interesting thing is that they will speak, most of them will mention how they died. And then in the majority of the cases, they will say they died violently. They died frequently in accidents, or they were murdered, or they were killed in war, and so on. That's very common. And then they frequently have phobias of things that relate to how they died. For example, if they say they drowned, they will have fear of water. That's common. And then they have specific psychological characteristics. I will come to that later. And then they have also what we call a post-traumatic stress disorder. People who have been faced death have experienced, and it stays with them, and this fear of death remains there. Well, I think, besides, someone have birthmarks that are related to how they died, according to them, in the previous life. This is one case of Tushita Silva, who lived in Sri Lanka, and I studied that case very well. She was born of poor parents, and she stayed stated that she had lived in Akulesha, that is a town far away from the town where she lived. And she said that this father had been Yedin Nanayakara. And then he said there was a river close by and with a bridge, a walking bridge. And once she was walking over the river, she fell into the river and drowned. And her husband was with her and tried to save her, but he almost drowned himself. And so on. She made several statements. And then we investigated these claims, and then we found in Akulesha, there is a river that goes through the city, it's a small city, small town, and then we found this one bridge, and then we asked around if there was, if someone had fallen into the river from this bridge. Yes, they said there was a, in a nearby house, there was the Nanayakara family, and their daughter-in-law had fallen into the river and drowned. But the girl had said she had she was pregnant when she drowned, fell into the river. She lived in a painted house. And she lived in a larger house than the present one, but she was born in a very poor family and they lived in a clay house. Yeah. So this fitted very well. And this is the Chandranayakara, the girl that fell into the river and drowned. And this is her husband that tried to save her, but almost drowned himself. So when we look at this, how it fits together time-wise, Chandranayakara, the girl that drowned, she was born in 46, and she died in November 73. But Tushita Silva, who claimed to have fallen into the river in Akulesha, and so on, she was born in 82, and so on. So so there were some, what was it, 9 years in between, which is not unusual. Although on the Emirates, the time between is shorter than this. Yeah. Well, this is another case of from Lebanon. Nazi Aldana. It was a young boy born near Beirut in Lebanon in 1992, and at the age of about 2 years, almost as soon as he could speak, he started to speak about a life, about a previous life. And it is usually so with these children, they start to talk about their previous life. So at the age of 2 to 3, or almost as soon as they know how to talk. Yeah. And he made many statements. Yeah. And for example, he said he had two pistols, he carried two pistols, 4 grenades. And he was a fearless, strong person. And he was big, not small, and he had children, and he had a new friend, he had a lot of weapons. And then he said about his previous wife, she was prettier than his present wife, present mother, and he had a house, and so on, and so on. And then he was attacked by people, he shot at them, but he was killed, and so on and so forth. Yeah. And there were many witnesses because the boy had several brothers and sisters. So I could verify with them what the boy had been telling and also, of course, from the mother and the father. And the boy said he had lived, just a moment now, I told him, he had lived, he had lived in Kapur Shamu, that is, was a village, some distance from his home. And he almost wanted them, his parents to bring him there. And he told them he could show them the way. So they went to the Kapur Shamu, and then they came to a crossroad. And the boy told them, you should go down this way and take the first turn on the left. And that they did. And this was at the end of the road. And then the boy ran up here and said he had lived somewhere here. But then the car stayed here with the mother and I think one or two of the brothers and sisters. And then someone came down here. You have seen. And asked them what they were doing here. Well, they told that boy that the little boy was claiming he had lived here and he had been killed in an attack. And then the boy said, well, this just happened to our family. Because this is the boy who met them. This is the mother, who is a widow, and she had been married to a man who was a lifeguard to a leading figure of the Jewish community in Beirut. So he was his bodyguard, almost heavily armed. But one day, or one night rather, there was an attack on the Jewish center. This is their family before. This is Fort Kadash, who was killed at an attack of the Jewish center in Lebanon. And he worked there for many, many years. And he was the manager and one of Sheikh Al-Aqul and Jumblatt's bodyguards. And he was assassinated in 1982. This is the Jewish center in Lebanon. It's sort of the center of the Jewish religion in Lebanon. And it was attacked one night. The guards and gates were killed. And they invaded the building and they killed this man who was the bodyguard of Jumla. Well, this is a news of the assassination and the attack in a Beirut newspaper. And that is it. And then when they had found this house where they had lived, then the lady there, the widow, she asked him who built the gate. Found this gate, and the boy said, a man from the Farets family. And she was rather critical of him. And she also asked, did she have an accident when they lived in Aina? They had lived in a close by house earlier. Yes, she had fallen and dislocated her shoulder. And so on, quite a number of questions. And then the boy also asked the mother, or the widow, if she remembered certain things. And she did, because verified. This case was almost too good to be true. It was really a very remarkable case. And once she had come drunk home, and she locked him out. And then he asked, the boy asked, where is the bottle that I taught you to shoot? Lebanon is a very rather violent country. Guns all around, and they have a civil war there, and so on and so forth. Yeah, and they showed them that this was the barrel still there. And then they also met the former brother of Fuad Qaddas, the man who had been killed. And he asked the boy, what is the proof that you are my brother? He said, I once gave you a pistol. And he asked him, what kind of pistol? It was a Czech 16. And later he brought a pistol to the boy and asked. But the boy said, this is not a pistol, it was a different pistol. And then they became convinced about that this was it. And then he showed them a picture of three men. And here they are, the three brothers, and he recognized them. And the man furthest to the left, that was the one who was killed, assassinated. Yes, and they asked more questions. And answered them very satisfactorily. Yes. So the statements he made were most of them fitted. There was one that I did not fit. And honestly, I don't remember now which one it was. And four were unverifiable. They might have been wrong, might have been right. There was no way to verify or falsify. Yeah, so he made a lot of statements, and most of them fitted very nicely. And Fuad Qaddas, the man who was assassinated, he was born in 1925, and he died in July 2nd, 82. But Nazi Aldana, he was born, 9 to 10 years later. Here's another case. Of Punyam Ekanayaka from Sri Lanka. She started at the usual age, 2 to 3, to speak about her past life. Now I can't really see this, but anyway, she made different statements. But they asked her where she had lived before. She couldn't tell them, but one night there was a documentary in Sri Lankan television, and there was the Kelaniya temple there. And then she told them she had lived close to the Kelaniya temple, but on the other side of the river, that close by the Kelaniya temple. And she had also said she had been an incense maker. Her father was a master of a school, and then at the school was hired a man who was from Kelaniya. So he heard about what had been saying, and he went around to check this. And then she found, she had lived on the other side of the liver, and she has been making antica pizza. Insect sticks, and she has been sending insect sticks, and once when he was bringing insect sticks to the market, she was overrun by a big vehicle, by a bus, and she died. And there turned out to be an incense maker on the other side of the river, Vici Siri, and he had previously had a colleague, they were two of them who worked together, but he had died several years ago when he was bringing incense to the market. And that's how it died. Well, and they have been making Ambika and Vita Vita incense, and she had a prominent birthmark here on there, but I brought the postmodern report about Jinnadas, about that mark, and there was a big fracture of the ribs and so on. So this fitted very nicely with the birth marks. This is a the bus had been, it was a heavy bus, it had driven across her body like that and broken the ribs. Well, how was my time?
Well, not very much time, unfortunately.
Some
minutes, yes.
Less than four.
Four more minutes. Okay. Well, we'll just go quickly through this. This is Purnima in a festive fashion. And then we have a case from Iceland. There was a boy there who claimed to have lived up in the country. He was born in Reykjavik in the city. And he started at an early age and had another mother that he wanted to go to his real mother and that he wanted to go to his up in the country. And there was a man there who lived in the family. Well, it so turned out that, yes, and there had been a factor that turned over and someone died. And But it turned out that the brother of his father, he had been killed in a tractor accident up in the country. So it seemed that he was the man that the boy seemed to be remembering. Yeah. Well, I think it's not time to go there. His half-brother Harold died in a bankruptcy in 69. And this is the farm. Yeah. And this man who died in the traffic accident, he died on the 18th of July, 69. But the boy, Einar Jonsson, born in Reykjavik, was born a week later. It's very unusual, very close. Yeah. Well, then the question is, how do we interpret these cases? Is there a normal, non-transcendental interpretation? For example, could it be that these are correlations really just based on chance? That seems very unlikely, besides these birthmarks are a problem, because they are created in the womb. But could it be that these children have some psychic abilities, like a recognition, so they focus back on someone who has lived before, and or could it be a kind of possession of the person who died, possessing the person, the child who has this experience. But then we have a problem in the birth mark. Well, then the most commonly interpretation is reincarnation, namely that his children are remembered events in their past life. Well, I wrote a book about this with a lot of cases that I studied. I studied about 100 cases.
How?
About 100 cases. Oh, I spent a lot of time on this, yes. And there were about many in Sri Lanka that they are not difficult to find, and also in Lebanon, and then they have a few in other places. But very interesting. And well, I hope I am in time. Yes, if you want to look at a little bit further on my, you can look at my web page, and there you can find some of my published papers. They can be downloaded from my web page.
А сейчас вопросы по-английски. If you have any questions,
yes. Thank you for your report. It's incredible for us, I suppose. And
what about you in Russia?
But we know about Blavatsky, and I told you about this book by Sylvia Cranston.
Yes.
She was a biographer for HBB. And in what way, how could you find them, all of them? I can't imagine.
How could I find the cases?
Yes, yes.
Well, Stevenson had
previously
worked in Sri Lanka. So he had like a sort of co-workers who would question around.
Uh-huh.
And then since belief in reincarnation is in line with Buddhism, that is the religion of Sri Lanka, then sometimes even the newspapers, when the
newspapers
spoken about the past life, they can bring it in their newspapers. And then there was one assistant of Stevenson who worked for him for quite a number of years, and he wrote a little book about cases, Sri Lankan cases, that was published and became very popular. So if someone if they came up a case, they might write to him and tell him, we know of a case. So I knew, came to know about these cases from different sources, and often also when we were investigating some case, then we were told, well, we also know another case. So in that way we got also some new cases.
Uh-huh.
And it was similar in Lebanon, but the Druze, they are, of course, they have their own religion, although they're usually classified as Islamic, but they are not really Islamic. So they are somewhat hiding their religion, but I had some people who were members of the Druze community, they helped me to find cases.
They believe in this?
Yes, they believe, yes. Yes.
They help.
Yes.
All right, any other questions? No. Well, one more question from me. Well, you used some examples with the children, and two of them were about 8 or 9 years old. And what was the...
Well, the children were, when they started to speak about the past, yes, they were usually 2 to 3 years old.
And I wanted to ask how old were the youngest children whose statements were checked?
Yeah. How old were they? When we did it?
Probably.
Yes.
Somebody checked their statements.
Well, of course, we almost never found a child when it had just begun to speak. They were often 8, 9, 10, 12 years or even older when we learned about the case. But then we would interview them, and we would interview their brothers and sisters if they remember them talking about the past life. Mm-hmm. And then we could interview the parents, and yes, they would remember when they started, mm-hmm, and so on. So we tried to investigate this case very thoroughly, almost like these were legal cases, and we wanted to find out, and we were also aware of the weaknesses of the witnesses, so we tried to get as many witnesses to each case as possible.
Any other questions?
No questions.
No.
And the last question. Do you know films by Israel director, the film Unmistaken Child? Do you know? About the reincarnation of Dalai Lama in Nepal.
No,
this is documentary film. Yes, I'll find it and I'll show you. This is incredible as well.
As well. There has been much discussion in the USA about someone who remembered being a fighter pilot,
uh-huh, uh-huh,
and reported on it, and there was published a book about it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.